Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 29th of May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis will be available in the description section and also in the comment section given below for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our analysis. The first article of the day is the editorial title, "The Key Agenda Must Be to Accelerate Growth." The author of this editorial stresses the fact that the new government need to focus on the growth of the economy. The analysis of this editorial will be helpful in your prelims preparation under economic development and also in your mains preparation under Indian economy and issues relating to planning, mobilization of resources, growth, development and also employment. Now, the author in this editorial has given the major issues that are causing the slowdown in the growth of economy and also the suggestions for each and every issue. So, the author has mainly touched four important areas which you need to know. They are investments, banking sector, employment and agrarian distress. Now, we have given in a comparison format where we will be seeing all these four issues and their corresponding suggestions that the author has given for these issues. Finally, the author has also discussed in short about the importance of social safety nets. Now, the author starts the editorial with the official data of revised new base estimates for the growth rate. According to the revised new base estimates, the growth rate in the financial year 2016-17 was 8.2%. In the financial year 2018-19, it was 7%. Now, it is very much clear from this data that the growth is slowing down. The author tells that the first priority of the government must be to accelerate economic growth. He tells that only a fast growing economy will generate the surplus revenue. And this surplus revenue will be helpful to address many of our socio-economic problems and also to provide social safety nets. So, we shall see about this social safety nets in the later part of our analysis. The first issue that is being discussed by the author is the investments. The author tells that there is a decline in the investment rate. So, he has mentioned two official economic indicators. They are gross fixed capital formation to the GDP ratio and capital expenditure data of the corporate sector. First, let us see about gross fixed capital formation to GDP ratio. Here, the fixed capital means the fixed assets such as land, plant, machinery, building, public infrastructure, etc. So, gross fixed capital formation means the total creation of the fixed assets. When this gross fixed capital formation is calculated as a percentage of GDP, then it is referred to as gross fixed capital formation to GDP ratio. So, this indirectly denotes that the asset formation is possible only when there are investments. The author quotes the official values here. In current prices, the ratio of gross fixed capital formation to the gross domestic product, nothing but the GDP, in the financial year 2018-19 is estimated at 28.9%. But if you see the 2007-2008 data, it was as high as 35.8%. So, this clearly denotes that the investments have gone down. The author suggests that for a sustained growth of the economy, this particular ratio has to substantially increase. Next, the author notes that there is a fall in corporate investment. The author has quoted RBI's forecast of corporate investment, which is published every year. In the financial year of 2017-18, the capital expenditures of the corporate sector were estimated at 1487 billion rupees. Now, if you see, this is a steady decline from the 2050 billion rupees amount of capital expenditures in the financial year 2014-15. The author also tells that the investments in the manufacturing sector are especially slow. So, the author stresses the need for more investments in the Indian economy, especially more public investments. The author tells that the public investment through budget route is very less, which is just 1.6% of the GDP that is being estimated for this particular financial year. So if you also see the previous years, this ratio has not changed much. The author notes that more contribution to the public investments comes from public sector enterprises, which also includes the railways. So he suggests that the government can interact with all the public sector units and prepare a common program of public investment for the financial year 2019-20. Here, you should know that the public sector units can take a longer term view on capital investments when compared to the private sector, since mostly the private sector will invest on short term gains. So in this case, a strong public investment program can also act as a catalyst for private investment, which the author notes. Next, he stresses on the need to have a sector-wise investment approach in order to attract more investments. Let us see the second issue raised by the author now, which is the banking sector. The author tells that the banks are under a heavy stress and the ratio of the non-performing assets has risen. The author tells that the primary activity of the bank is lending money. If NPAs are higher, then the bank is likely to have a capital shortage. The author suggests that the government must infuse adequate capital into banks. Also, he suggests that the NPA related cases can be resolved through resolution councils or committees instead of taking the legal route, that is the investigative agency's route, which is being mentioned in the editorial. We saw that lending is the primary activity of any bank, especially the working capital. But in the absence of long-term lending financial institutions, the banks provide both working capital and also long-term loans. So the author suggests that as a medium-term plan, the government should consider setting up of a separate long-term financial institution, which would partly be funded by the government. The third issue that the author has taken up is related to employment. The author comments that the economy is not able to generate adequate employment. He also tells that the answer to the problem of jobs is only growth, where only faster growth and faster investment will generate more employment, and an improvement in the financial system may trigger some new jobs. So he tells that the overall growth is key to more employment. Finally, the author has discussed about the issue of agrarian distress. Here he mentions one dimension of growth, which is growth will happen only if there is an adequate increase in demand. So here the key word is demand. The author notes that the main concern is the slowdown in the rural demand, and the agrarian distress is the main cause of slowdown in the overall demand. So agrarian distress must be tackled on a priority basis. The author suggests that when the distress is due to a fall in prices of the agricultural crops, the best course of action is to resort to limited procurement so that the excess over normal is procured by the government and there will be a price balance in the market. Next, we know that monsoon is always unpredictable in India because a few years the monsoon is very good, but few years we face drought-like conditions. So the author suggests that it is best to keep changing the cropping pattern based on the rainfall in that particular year. Also, he suggests that agricultural inputs such as seeds and fertilizers should be made available by the state governments at a very cheap cost. The author has also given some suggestion to tackle the agrarian distress with some medium-term plans, which we'll be seeing now. Firstly, he stresses for the consolidation of land holdings so that the overall agricultural productivity can be increased. Here, the consolidation of land holding means just pooling in all the fragmented lands of each and every small and marginal farmers so that when they cultivate together, the overall agricultural productivity will increase. The second thing is introducing better techniques for cultivation, which can be promoted by the government. The third thing is the marketing of the agricultural produce. He tells that the marketing of the agricultural produce is very unhelpful, such that the farmers not get better prices for their crops at present. So he's suggesting to improve the marketing arrangements which are at present. So these are the four issues that have been discussed by the author, where he has also given the suggestions of plans that have to be carried out in the short term period. The author has largely focused on the short term plans in this editorial. If you see, He has also noted that the medium-term reforms such as GST, the goods and service tax, then IBC, the insolvency and bankruptcy code, and the land reforms and also the labor reforms should all be dealt with only after leading the economy to a higher growth path with the help of these short-term plans. Now, along with the suggestions, the author has also asked the government to keep a watch on the money flow in the economy, which is nothing but the liquidity flow, which is mentioned in the editorial. And he's also asking to focus on the monetary policy so that the efforts of the government that it takes to have a higher growth rate are in a very sustainable manner. Finally, the author has discussed about social safety nets. If you remember, we just saw this during the first para of our article. So the social safety net means the welfare programs of the government for the poorest and the weakest sections of the society. And it can also include the vulnerable sections of the society. Now, one such program is providing minimum income to the poor. So here in this editorial, the author is welcoming this providing minimum income to the poor, but is also wary of the fact that such welfare schemes should not disturb the fiscal stability of the government. Here the fiscal stability means the revenues and the expenditures that the government makes and gets. So this should not be disturbed just because by introducing such a scheme. Also, he suggests consolidating or clubbing all the existing subsidies for the poor and providing them in the form of minimum income support. So, if all the subsidies are clubbed, the fiscal stability of the government can be ensured by the government. Finally, the author concludes that besides the economic factors, some other non-economic factors should also be considered for having or achieving a high growth levels, like a peaceful society and also a peaceful political condition in India. Both these should prevail in India so that India is able to achieve higher growth levels. So this growth will generate high revenues, and this would be able to create jobs and also sustain the welfare programs of the government. With this, we come to the analysis of this editorial. Now, have a look at the practice mains question. We shall discuss at the end of the analysis session. Let us now move on to our next news article. The next article is titled as Ozone Pollution Likely to Spike in Capital. The discussion based on this article will be relevant in your prelim syllabus under current events of national importance and also under general science. This discussion can also be linked to your mains preparation in General Studies Paper 3 under Environmental Pollution and Degradation. The news article states that according to a forecast by the System of Air Quality and Weather Forecasting and Research, that is SUFFER in short, due to the rising temperatures, the surface ozone pollution is expected to increase in the city of Delhi. The air quality index on Tuesday was in the moderate category, and this is expected to slowly deteriorate to the higher end of the moderate category in the next 2 days. According to SUFFER, the cause for this deterioration will be ozone, and this ozone will be the lead pollutant. So with the increased temperature, the production of surface ozone will also increase. Now let us see what is this surface ozone. Surface ozone is also called as ground level ozone. The surface ozone is created through the interactions of man-made and also natural emissions of volatile organic compounds, in short VOCs, and also nitrogen oxides in the presence of heat and sunlight. But remember, the stratospheric ozone forms naturally in the upper atmosphere, and this protects us from the sun's harmful ultraviolet rays. Here, the volatile organic compounds are defined as organic species which have high vapor pressure in the Earth's atmosphere. The cars and gasoline burning engines are large sources of volatile organic compounds. Also, volatile organic compounds are emitted from consumer products. If you see like paints, insecticides, cleaners, as well as industrial solvents, and also from chemical manufacturing. Next, coming to nitrogen oxides, they are produced whenever fossil fuels are burnt and are primarily produced by motor vehicles and power plants. The sun's direct ultraviolet rays convert these emissions into surface ozone, which becomes very much unhealthy to breathe. The ozone concentrations can reach unhealthful levels when the weather is hot and sunny with little or no wind. The high concentrations of ozone near ground level can be harmful to people and also to animals, crops, and also to other materials. This particular ozone can irritate your respiratory system, causing you to start coughing, where also you'll get a feeling of irritation in your throat and or an experience an uncomfortable sensation also in your chest. This ozone can aggravate asthma and can cause inflammation and damage cells that line your lungs as well. The ozone may also aggravate chronic lung diseases such as bronchitis and reduce the immune system's ability to fight off bacterial infections in the respiratory system. And finally, the ozone may cause permanent lung damage. These effects can be worse in children and also in exercising adults. In this context, now let us see what is meant by this SUFFER. SUFFER is the acronym for System of Air Quality and Weather Forecasting. So this system is a first of its kind in the country. Under the planned scheme, Metropolitan Advisories for Cities for Sports and Tourism, under the Metropolitan Air Quality and Weather Services, the Ministry of Earth Sciences under the Government of India has introduced this as a major national initiative. This particular initiative was developed indigenously by the Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology, which is located in Pune, and it is operationalized by the Indian Meteorological Department. This particular SUFFER system provides location-specific information on air quality in near real time. It forecasts 1 to 3 days in advance, which is the first time in India. As of now, SUFFER is implemented in 4 cities of India, in the cities of Delhi, Pune, Mumbai and Ahmedabad as an operational service. The system is an integral part of India's first air quality early warning system, which is operational in Delhi. The ultimate objective of this project is to increase the awareness among the general public regarding the air quality in their city, that too very much well in advance. This is because appropriate mitigation measures and systematic action can be taken up for betterment of air quality and related health issues. It engineers awareness drive by educating public, prompting self mitigation, and also to help develop mitigation strategies for the policy makers. So SUFFER will accelerate the public awareness and also preparedness of air pollution and weather extremes. It will also lead to better understanding of linkages among emissions, weather, pollution and climate. It will also monitor all the weather parameters like the ultraviolet radiation, the temperature, rainfall, humidity, wind speed, wind direction, and also solar radiation. In addition to all this, to regularly monitor the air quality parameters like PM1, PM2.5, PM10, where PM is the particulate matter, then sulfur dioxide, ozone, nitrogen oxides like NO and NO2, then carbon monoxide, methane, the volatile organic compounds. The system will also monitor the existence of benzene, toluene and xylene as well in addition to all these here. Besides health, the SUFFER system benefits to several other sectors like agriculture, aviation, infrastructure, disaster management skill, tourism and many others, which directly or indirectly gets affected by air quality and weather. The SUFFER observational network of air quality monitoring stations and automatic weather stations are established within the city limits. They represent selected micro environments of the city, including industrial, residential, background or cleaner urban complex, agricultural zones, etc., as per the international guidelines, which ensures a true representation of city environment. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion of this news article. Now, have a look at the practice prelims question. We shall discuss at the end of the analysis session. Let us move on to the next news article. The next news article of the day is titled, Sri Lanka, Japan and India sign deal to develop container terminal. This news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance, and also in your mains preparation in General Studies Paper 2, under India and its neighborhood relations, and also under bilateral regional groupings and agreements involving India and or affecting India's interests. Now, there are 6 main sea ports in the country of Sri Lanka, and Colombo Port is one among them. In Colombo Port, there are 5 terminals, and one among them is the East Container Terminal. Now, this article tells that an agreement was signed between Sri Lanka, Japan, and India to jointly develop the East Container Terminal at the Colombo Port. According to the agreement, only the terminal operations company at the East Container Terminal will be jointly owned to develop the terminal. This company will be owned with a 51% stake by the Sri Lanka and the remaining 49% stake with India and Japan. Now, the percentage of ownership of Japan and India are not clear as of now. The terminal in itself will be absolutely or 100% owned by the Sri Lankan government, by the Port Authority of Sri Lankan government. Now, the overall news simply means that the 3 countries will jointly build the East Container Terminal at the port of Colombo in the agreed terms. So, just remember this. This joint initiative is estimated to cost between $500 million and $700 million. And Japan has agreed to give a 40-year soft loan with a 0.1% interest rate. Here, you should note that the interest is just 0.1%. So, the loan means that the borrower gets the loan on soft terms, in other words, in less rate of interest over the interest rate that actually prevails in the market. Such loans are called as concessional funding or soft financing. Also, Japan has been a long-standing partner for Sri Lanka and one of Sri Lanka's biggest donors in the recent decades. The Jaya Container Terminal at the Colombo Port was developed with the help of Japan, which supported its operations since 1980s. This news is important in the relations that India has with respect to Sri Lanka, because last year, even with the Sri Lankan within the Sri Lankan government, the President of Sri Lanka and the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka had differences of opinion in the involvement of India in developing this particular terminal, because the President was against India's involvement in the national asset of Sri Lanka, which is nothing but this terminal, whereas the Prime Minister supported India. However, diplomatic efforts were taken for the development of the port and the relation between the 2 countries after the entry of Japan. It has been stated that the significant proportion of the transshipment business at the East Container Terminal and even the Colombo Port are linked to India. Now, the speciality of this deal is that here the sovereignty of the Sri Lankan government is not affected, because Sri Lanka is going to have a majority stake of 51% in this joint initiative. But if you see the adjoining terminal, which is called as the Colombo International Container Terminal in the Colombo port, the Sri Lankan government just owns 15% in the stake of the port, whereas the remaining 85% of the stake is with China. Also, the entire Hambantota seaport is also with China on a 99-year lease, as Sri Lanka could not pay the loan obtained from China. So, this is all you need to know about this particular news article. Now, let us move on to the next news article. The next news is that diphtheria resurfaces in Thiruvananthapuram district of the state of Kerala, where a 10-year-old boy from Parashala tests positive for diphtheria. In this context, let us see about diphtheria from prelims point of view. The information given under this article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance, and next under general science. And it will also be relevant in your mains preparation in general studies paper 2 under issues relating to development and management of social sector services relating to health. Diphtheria is caused by a bacterium called Cornibacterium diphtheria. This disease primarily affects the throat and upper airways. Also, this bacterium produces a toxin that affects the other organs of the body as well. So, if you see the major symptoms of diphtheria, they include a sore throat, low levels of fever, swollen glands in the neck. Now, the diphtheria toxin that is produced by this bacteria causes a membrane of dead tissues. So, this will build up over the throats and tonsils in the human body, and because of this, the humans will find breathing and swallowing difficult. Next, let us see the mode of transmission of this diphtheria disease. Diphtheria can spread through direct physical contact. Also, they can spread through air, which means they are airborne. So even the cough or sneeze of an infected individual can be dangerous to a healthy individual. Now, if you've seen the news article, the health administration of that particular Thiruvananthapuram district has told that all the family members or the contacts would be administered with necessary medication since it is an airborne infection. Now, if you see, diphtheria is fatal in 5 to 10% of the cases, which means if 100 cases of diphtheria are reported, at least 5 or 10 people will die. So this high mortality in the death, that is the death rates, can especially be seen amongst the young children. Now let us see the treatment of diphtheria. Diphtheria can be treated by administering diphtheria antitoxin. So how this antitoxin will work is like they will neutralize the effects of the toxin that is produced by this diphtheria bacteria. Also antibiotics are prescribed which will kill the bacteria. Next, coming to the vaccine, there is a diphtheria vaccine which is available for curing the diphtheria. This diphtheria vaccine is a bacterial toxoid. So here toxoid means a toxin whose toxicity has been inactivated. The vaccine is normally given in combination with other vaccines as a DTP vaccine or pentavalent vaccine. So here a DTP means diphtheria, tetanus, whooping cough vaccine, or the pertussis vaccine, and a pentavalent means DTP vaccine plus two more vaccines. Here just know that penta means 5. Now for adolescents and adults, the diphtheria toxoid is frequently combined with tetanus toxoid in lower concentrations. So here you need to know by the term adolescents. Adolescents means the individual in the age group of 13 to 19 years. So this particular definition is given in the National Youth Policy by the Government of India. Now the World Health Organization recommends a 3-dose primary vaccination series with a diphtheria containing vaccine followed by 3 booster doses. Now just know this for knowledge point of view, you need not require this for your exam preparation. If you see, the primary vaccination series should begin as early as 6 week of age, with subsequent doses given with a minimum interval of 4 weeks between each doses. Now the 3 booster doses, they should preferably be given at the age of 12 to 23 months, which is the first dose, and at 4 to 7 years, which is the second dose, and also at 9 to 15 years, which is the third dose. Ideally, there should be at least 4 years between each booster doses. Now have a look at the practice prelims question. We shall discuss at the end of the analysis session. Let us move on to the next news article. The next news article is titled as Post Balakot, Indian Air Force zeroes in on key vulnerability. The discussion based on this article will be relevant in your prelim syllabus under current events of national importance and also under general science. This particular discussion can also be linked to your main syllabus in general studies paper 3 under science and technology. Next, under Achievements of Indians in Science and Technology, Indigenization of Technology and Developing New Technology. The news article states that after the Balakot airstrike, the Indian Air Force has identified a shortage of airborne warning and control system, in short the AVACS aircraft. Because the AVACS provides round-the-clock surveillance, this shortage of this particular AVACS can be seen as a major deficiency. The airstrike and the aerial engagement that followed in the month of February were discussed in detail at the recent Air Force Commanders Conference. Here, one of the senior officials noted that the Indian Air Force needs to have high-end fighters for short skirmishes or irregular fighting. For increasing the resources, the IAF is depending on the Rafale fighters, which are to be inducted soon. If you see, a new fighter aircraft and the indigenous light combat aircraft MK-2 that is being developed are making up for the shortage as of now. The aircraft induction is a long-term measure. So in the short term, the IAF or the Indian Air Force has identified AVACS, software-defined radios and close-in weapon systems as immediate requirements. Additionally, the news article is also telling that Pakistan currently has an advantage because they have more AVACS when compared to us. So the Pakistan is having 7 AVACS and is able to keep 1 AVACS on the Indian side to have surveillance over India. Currently, IAF operates 3 Israeli Falcon AVACS and 2 indigenous Netra Airborne Early Warning and control system. The NETRA system is developed by the Defense Research and Development Organization, and soon the Indian Air Force is set to take the third NETRA system from DRDO. Now, we saw something about AVACS and also about NETRA from this news article. So, let us discuss some facts about both these from examination point of view. First, let us see AVACS. AVACS is the acronym for Airborne Warning and Control System. So, this AVACS is an airborne surveillance radar. It can maintain situational awareness of the potential targets and also the friendly aircrafts over hundreds of square miles of airspace, and that also in all the directions. So, it is a force multiplier technology which is available with modern air forces around the world. By operating radars from airborne platforms, the airspace can be monitored from ranges of more than 400 kilometers away. If you see, the AVACS is similar to operational headquarters that operates from the land, but this AVACS operates in the air. The AVACS system can detect threats and provide early warning of enemy aircraft and also the missiles. It can also direct its own aircraft and air defense systems to neutralize the threat. Now, let us see about NETRA. NETRA is an airborne early warning and control aircraft, or in short the AEWNC aircraft. This particular NETRA provides surveillance and radar coverage for combat fighter jets. Now, if you remember the Balakot airstrikes that was carried out by India, it was a NETRA that guided the entire mission, and it was the operational brain behind the attack. NETRA is indigenously designed and developed by the scientists of the Defense Research and Development Organization. This particular NETRA system alerts the pilots of incoming missiles, as it has infrared detection capability. The infrared detection capability can see the hot exhaust of the missiles. As per DRDO sources, NETRA can track targets which are 450 to 500 kilometer deep into the enemy territory. For example, without crossing the line of control, we can track the targets in Pakistan. Also, while being airborne, that is while flying, this particular NETRA has an almost 120 degree view of enemy territory. So, NETRA can secretly listen to all the communications that take place among the enemy's armed forces. It also gathers all the electronic intelligence and beams it back live to the commanders on the ground. NETRA is capable of flying for 5 hours at a stretch. But with air-to-air refueling, that is refueling in the mid-air, it can also fly for 9 hours. Now, have a look at the practice prelims question. We shall discuss at the end of the analysis session. Let us move on to the next news article. The next article is titled as Scientists Give the Thumbs Up for Anthropocene Epoch. The discussion under this article will be relevant in your prelim syllabus under Current Events of International Importance. The news article talks about new geological epoch. Here, epoch means a division of time, that is a subdivision of a period, and it is subdivided into ages corresponding to a series in chronostratigraphy. If you see, this is a new geological epoch which is going to be designated, and this epoch is named as Anthropocene epoch. The kinds of decisions like designating a new geological epoch is not a very easy task. The decision has to undergo a lot of scrutiny. So, for designating Anthropocene epoch, a 34-member panel of the Anthropocene Working Group, or AWG, voted in favor of this decision. Know that the AWG was established in the year 2009 as a working group within the International Commission on Stratigraphy. ICS regulates the way in which the time, name, rank, and stratigraphic markers of new geological periods are approved. You should know that stratigraphy is the branch of geology that is concerned with the order and relative position of strata and their relationship to the geological timescale. According to journal Nature, the panel plans to submit a formal proposal to the International Commission on Stratigraphy for the new epoch, that is by the year 2021. Once a formal proposal is made by the AWG, it will be considered by several more groups of the International Commission on Stratigraphy. The final ratification will be made by the Executive Committee of the International Union of Geological Sciences. enough. This vote by the panel signals the end of the Holocene epoch, which began 11,700 years ago. But keep in mind that the Anthropocene is currently not a formally defined geological unit within the geological timescale. We officially still live within the Megalian age of the Holocene epoch. Now, let us know some facts about the Anthropocene. Here, anthropo means human or humanoid, and scene means new, which usually denotes a geological period. The term Anthropocene was coined in the year 2000 by Nobel laureate Paul Crutzen and Eugene Stürmer. The Anthropocene denotes the present geological time interval. And during this time interval, the human activity has profoundly altered many conditions and processes on Earth. Remember that the Anthropocene is coined as a geological time unit and as a potential addition to the geological time scale. According to AWG, the phenomena associated with the Anthropocene include the following. Firstly, an order of magnitude increase in erosion and sediment transport, which is associated with urbanization and agriculture. Here, the order of magnitude is a class in the system of classification, which is determined by size. Then, marked and abrupt anthropogenic perturbations or alterations of the cycles of elements such as carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus, and various metals together with new chemical compounds could happen. The next phenomena is the environmental changes generated by these perturbations or alterations, which are global warming, sea level rise, ocean acidification, and spreading of oceanic dead zones. The less oxygen dissolved in the water is often referred to as a dead zone because most marine life either dies or, if they are mobile such as fish, leave the area. These zones are also created because of human activity like nutrient pollution, which is the primary cause of dead zones that is created by the humans. Excess nutrients that run off land or are piped as wastewater into the river and coasts can stimulate an overgrowth of algae. So this algae overgrowth then sinks and decomposes in the water. The decomposition process consumes a lot of oxygen and thus it depletes the supply available to the healthy marine life, so that the marine life will not be having any oxygen to survive. Now, if you remember, a question on dead zones in Arabian Sea was asked in UPSC mains exam in the year 2018 in General Studies paper 1. Just have a look at that. The next phenomena associated with the Anthropocene include rapid changes in the biosphere, both on land and also in the sea. And this is happening as a result of habitat loss, predation, explosion of domestic animal populations, and species invasions. And finally, the proliferation or a rapid increase of many new minerals and rocks, and the global dispersion of these new minerals and rocks. They include concrete, fly ash, and plastics, and the countless techno-fossils produced from these and other materials are also the phenomena associated with the Anthropocene. Note that many of these changes will persist for millennia or longer, and they are altering the trajectory of the Earth system. Some of them even have a permanent effect on the Earth system. They are being reflected in a distinctive body of geological strata now accumulating, with potential to be preserved into the far future. Further, the focus is now on identifying a definitive geological marker. So this will technically be called as a global boundary stratotype section endpoint, or also called as golden spike. This golden spike is to signal the beginning of the Anthropocene epoch. The golden spike must be present globally and should be a part of deposits for the geological record. So many in the AWG believe that artificial radionuclides would serve as a golden spike for Anthropocene, because it is spread across the world by the atomic bomb tests from the early 1950s. The radionuclides are present almost everywhere, if you see from the marine sediments to the ice layers and even in the stalagmites and stalactites. Know that a stalactite is an icicle-shaped formation that hangs from the ceiling of a cave. You'd have seen this in some movies as well. It is produced by precipitation of minerals from water dripping through the cave ceiling. So most stalactites have pointed tips, whereas a stalagmite is an upward growing mound of mineral deposits. These all have precipitated from water dripping onto the floor of a cave. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. Now have a look at the practice prelims question, we shall discuss at the end of the analysis session. Let us move on to the next news article. This final news article is to clarify yesterday's news article on burnout. In yesterday's article, we saw that burnout was declared as a medical condition for the first time in ICD-11, which is nothing but the 11th revision of the International Classification of Diseases by the World Health Organization. Here, the World Health Organization has mistakenly said that it had listed burnout in its International Classification of Diseases for the first time and also as a medical condition. So, both these are wrong. The World Health Organization has clarified that burnout remains an occupational phenomenon that could lead someone to seek care, but it is not considered as a medical condition. So, please keep this in mind that burnout is not a medical condition but just an occupational phenomenon. Also, burnout was listed in the previous version, that is in the ICD-10. If you see, ICD-10 was released in the year 1990, which is almost 19 years ago. Now, only the definition of burnout has been changed in the latest edition of the text. So that now the World Health Organization has defined burnout as a syndrome conceptualized as resulting from chronic workplace stress that has not been successfully managed. So, please take a note of this change made by the World Health Organization. Also, the revised PDF of the Hindu News Analysis on 28th of May 2019 is given in the link below. The question which was based on this wrong info which was given by the World Health Organization is also removed from the PDF. Let us now move on to the practice question discussion session. First question, with reference to the system of air quality and weather forecasting, suffer which among the following statements given below are correct? So here the first statement is correct as it is first of its kind in the country and provides location specific information on air quality in near real time. And also the forecast are 1 to 3 days given in advance, which is also the first time in India. So from this we can eliminate option C and D, which does not contain statement 1. Now, the second statement states that Suffer monitors air quality parameters such as PM2.5, carbon monoxide, benzene, toluene, etc. This is also correct because Suffer monitors PM1, particulate matter 2.5, PM10, sulfur dioxide, ozone, nitrogen oxides like NO1 and NO2, and also carbon monoxide, methane, volatile organic compounds, and also monitors the existence of benzene, toluene and xylene. So here the statement 2 is correct. Here in this question, if you see the remaining options A and B, B does not have statement 2. So from this the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 and 2. But also the statement 3 is partially correct as it is implemented in 4 cities of India. In Delhi, Pune, Mumbai and Ahmedabad, but not in Kolkata. So this particular statement is wrong. Then statement 4 is also wrong because keep in mind that Suffer was indigenously developed by the Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology, which is located in Pune, and not by the Indian Meteorological Department. But this particular program is operationalized by Indian Meteorological Department. So this question is asked for the correct statements. The correct answer is option A, 1 and 2 only. Moving on to the next question. With a reference to diphtheria, consider the following statements. They have given two statements. So here the first statement is a fact, which has already been mentioned in our discussion. That is, diphtheria is an airborne bacterial infection. So this statement is correct. Here the second statement is wrong. We are having diphtheria vaccines for treating diphtheria. It is not that vaccines are not available. So we also saw that diphtheria vaccine is used in combination as a DPT vaccine or pentavalent vaccine as well. So here the question is asked for the correct statements. The correct answer is option A, 1 only. Moving on to the next question. What is airborne warning and control system? In short, AVAX, sometimes seen in news. So in this question, if you see, it states airborne, But here all the options are related to air, so we cannot eliminate any option based on this. It has a warning word in the question, so this means we can somehow eliminate air-to-air missile option. And as this particular air-to-air missile option is a missile but not a warning system. And if you had paid attention to the analysis session, you know that AVACS is related to airborne military attack. So we can eliminate option A also because it is about air quality and not totally related to the military attack. Now the confusion may arise between option B and C, because both of them sound like they belong to the area military attack. But if you see option C, it is only missile approach warning and not other kinds of attack. Even though this option seems to be relevant, you cannot mark this option, because if you see in UPSC prelims examination, you have to choose the most relevant option. Here the airborne surveillance radar option means every type of surveillance in the air. So the most relevant and the correct option to this question is option B. Also remember that AVACS can detect threats and provide early warning of enemy aircraft and missiles. Also, it can direct its own aircraft and air defense systems to neutralize the threat. Moving on to the next question, the term Anthropocene, recently seen in news, denotes which among the following? So if you had paid attention to the analysis part, you know the correct answer directly. But if you have not paid attention to our analysis, then while answering this question, you can easily get tricked. Because many of us know that anthropo term is related to humans. So immediately we'll mark the option which has the mentioning of the word human here. Here we have human word in the option A. So if you mark this option, the answer is going to be wrong only. The word anthropo means humans only. But here the term Anthropocene ends with scene. So this scene denotes a new geological period and not robotics. So the correct answer to this question is option C, a new geological epoch. Anthropocene denotes the present geological time interval when the human activity has profoundly altered many conditions and processes on Earth. Now let us move on to the practice mains question. This will be appearing in paper 3. The question is, among several factors for sustaining India's potential growth rate, capital formation and investments are the most required one. Do you agree? What are the other factors available for sustaining the growth potential? Now, this question is partly an opinion-based question. The first statement here is an opinion-based statement. It asks if you agree that capital formation is the important factor for sustaining India's potential or higher growth rates. If you feel that capital formation, which means the formation of fixed assets such as public infrastructure, plant, machinery, etc., will increase India's growth rate, you can start your answer by mentioning the importance of capital formation and also the importance of investments in the capital formation. And but if you are not agreeing, you can just mention the other factors such as which you consider are most important for sustaining the higher growth rates. The second part of the question asks you to mention the other factors that are available to sustain the growth potential. So here you can mention the other factors such as stressed banking sector, unemployment, agrarian distress, etc. to answer this particular statement. We have discussed all these factors in our today's editorial analysis. With this, we come to the end of today's analysis of all the news articles along with the practice question discussion. Please do like, comment and share the video, and please do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.